So, welcome to lesson 12 of stoichiometric organometallics. Subject of today is metal-specific features. Well, today we talk about magnesium. And, as the subject, main subject is Grignard or Barbier. And you will soon know why there is a question mark. So, the Grignard reaction, you, of course, all know. General scheme of the Grignard reaction is an alkyl, aryl, or vinyl magnesium halide. Well, therefore, better put an X here. Normally it's bromide or chloride. Reacts with a carbonyl compound. A 1-2 addition reaction to the carbonyl group occurs. Forming the alcoholate, and after cautious hydrolysis, we will end up with, a tertiary, a secondary or primary alcohol. Well, depending, do we have some substituents that are simple hydrogen? So, this is the Grignard reaction. Sometimes the preceding reaction, the halide plus magnesium in an ether as solvent, reacting to give that carbon magnesium halide moiety. Sometimes this is called Grignard reaction. This is wrong. This is not the Grignard reaction. This is the formation of a Grignard reagent. These organometallic magnesium compounds are called Grignard reagents. Now, to the Barbier reaction. We start with in the original Barbier reaction, we start with an alkyl halide, but as to my knowledge, it also works with aryl and vinyl halides. Plus magnesium, plus a carbonyl component already present in the reaction mixture. Reaction starts. Well, generally one uses in case of magnesium, you use ether as a solvent, an ether, ether or THF. Well, and you will end with the alcohol just as we have seen it for the Grignard reaction after hydrolysis. So, what is the difference? The difference simply is that in the Barbier reaction, you perform it as a one-pot reaction. Not stepwise, just one pot. Actually, Barbier reaction or Barbier type reactions, which is often the expression which is in use, are not restricted to magnesium. You just could put in here a metal, and lots of metals are able to show this reaction. Lots of metals work just fine. Barbier was the first one who tested this in, the late 19th century. He started with zinc as a metal and soon found out that magnesium is more reactive. Grignard was a scholar of Barbier, doing his PhD synthesis in Barbier's group. And Grignard later on concentrated on magnesium chemistry and won the Nobel Prize in 1912. But all the stuff that Grignard examined was based on Barbier's work. Well, you might say a bit of Barbier's work is based, of course, on Wurtz. Wurtz, 40 years earlier, tried to treat alkyl halides with sodium, as you know, and getting Wurtz coupling products. We will see Wurtz coupling products later on, that's why I mentioned that. And it's Barbier's idea to use that combination of metal and a carbonyl group. Well, the Barbier reaction is still in use today and becomes more and more important. Mainly it's in use if you have allylic or benzylic halides as substrates. Simple example. First, magnesium plus, already a ketone present. Secondly, a hydrolysis. And we will get normally rather good result. In this case, the tertiary alcohol, the homoallylic alcohol. If you try this reaction stepwise, it is possible, but you have to be careful, very careful, with how to set up the formation of the allyl magnesium halide. We will later on see how this is done. But if you just perform the reaction according to Grignard, just as you have learned it in the undergraduate lab. So, having the magnesium activated in THF and then putting in the allylic bromide, then you have a competing reaction competing with Grignard reagent formation. And this very often becomes the main reaction pathway. This is a Wurtz coupling product. So the reason for that is that the Grignard formation at the magnesium surface is connected with single electron transfer processes, radical intermediates, and then you have stabilized allylic radicals, which have enough lifetime to wait until they get in contact with a second radical. Okay, forming that coupling product. One example of a successful synthesis using the magnesium-induced Wurtz coupling reaction is this one. So, with magnesium in ether, having high concentration, well, best is putting all that in and let it react with magnesium. So, how does the Wurtz coupling product look like? Hopefully it didn't make a mistake while drawing this. So, and hopefully you know this molecule. It's called squalene. It's an important natural product, important in the biosynthesis of steroids. Oh, okay, let's count. Just count the chain, okay? Yeah, it's correct. It's correct. So, as I mentioned earlier, first attempts from Barbier were with zinc, and zinc has also been tested in modern times. Zinc, THF, and water combination, ammonium chloride, room temperature 4.5 hours reaction time with that propargylic bromide. ~25% yield. Well, it is a remarkable reaction because it's organometallic chemistry with an aqueous solvent. Can't do that with magnesium. The yield is obviously not satisfying. But one can improve almost same reaction conditions allylic bromide. Again, THF water mixture, and now bulk indium as the metal. Leads also in the aqueous medium to the alcohol, and this time with 95% yield. This indium Barbier reaction in aqueous medium generally works with more than 70% yield, very often with more than 90% yield. With indium, you don't have the problem with a passivated surface. It works smoothly under very mild reaction conditions. Unfortunately, indium became more and more expensive in recent years. Next example, an aldehyde, Benz aldehyde, a vinyl triflate, two equivalents, DMF as a solvent, 1 hour reaction time at room temperature. And now it's a metal salt, chromium 2 chloride, and 2%, well, four equivalents of chromium 2 chloride, and 0.02 equivalents of nickel chloride, catalytic amounts of nickel. And this alcohol is obtained in 74% yield. While this nickel catalyzed chromium-induced Barbier-type reaction has a known name. It is the Nozaki-Hiyama-Kishi reaction. And it is known for its exceptional functional group tolerance. That means this reacts selectively with aldehydes in the presence of ketones. So, doesn't react or slowly with ketones, nitriles, and amides. So that means there might be some examples where there are some examples where the Nozaki-Hiyama-Kishi reaction well, has to be preferred. On the other hand, of course, one tries to avoid chromium salts out of all clear reasons. Now, an intramolecular Barbier reaction . This is a very, very sensitive functional group with samarium 2 iodide in THF minus 78 degrees, 6 hours reaction time. We get this cyclization product, 56% yield. Well, you might ask, how does this work? Well, end of the semester we will see some more samarium iodide induced reactions. Samarium 2 is easily oxidized to samarium 3. So that means, well, here you should have at least 2 equivalents of samarium iodide. First samarium iodide transfers an electron to this functional group, generating a radical center here. And in the samarium 3, the other equivalent also transfers an electron to the carbonyl group, forming a ketyl radical. And then you have an intramolecular coupling process between those radicalic centers. Indeed, you can call that also Barbier-type reaction. And as we will see now, the mechanism of the Barbier reaction is similar or analogous to the process we have discussed here for this case. Well, in the first glimpse, it's just the difference Barbier, Grignard, Barbier, one pot. No, there is also a different mechanism going on, generally. And this has been proven a couple of years ago. Well, you certainly know the adamantyl structure. This is adamantyl bromide. So, 2 experiments, or a bit more experiments, adamantyl bromide plus lithium, lithium metal. Diethyl ether, minus 20 degrees, 2 hours reaction time, hopefully gave the lithiated adamantane. That this worked was proven first. Ketone was added, and it was tried twice. Sterically hindered ketones, this bis tertiary butyl ketone, it's ketone A, and ketone B is adamantinone. This one. So, A or B E was added. Secondly, the reaction mixture was hydrolyzed with D2O. After work up, it turned out that monodeuterated adamantane was the main product, isolated with 70% yield, and the research group didn't find any alcohol deriving from the addition of adamantyl lithium to these sterically hindered carbonyl compounds. Then they did the reaction once again. So now almost the same setup, but they had A or B already present in the reaction mixture. So a Barbier type setup of a reaction. Again, diethyl ether minus 20 degrees, but they diminished the reaction time to just 45 minutes. Then adding D2O, and in this case, well, they got the alcohol as main product. In case of A, the bis tertiary butyl ketone. So that means that those R groups are tertiary butyl groups. 40% yield was obtained. And with adamantinone, 71% yield. This clearly proves that a different mechanism is going on, mainly a different mechanism in Barbier type reactions. So this is interpreted that adamantyl lithium at these low temperatures does not react with sterically hindered ketones, whereas ketyl radicals, well, in English it's ketyl, I think, radicals. Well, just that everyone knows what we are talking about. This would be the ketyl radical reacts with another reactive species, either adamantyl radical formed in situ or another radical anion, radical anion of adamantyl bromide. This is the interpretation of this result. Well, most important thing is, what should we learn about that? We were introduced into organometallic chemistry, everyone of us, I think, with a Grignard, normally with a Grignard reaction. And so, if we have to perform some organometallic reactions, our first choice is, then naturally, well, let's do it like Grignard, form the Grignard reagent. Actually, there is not the necessity to form organometallic species in bulk amount. Very often, with Barbier type setup, we get better results, much better results. So, another example where we have problems with the normal Grignard formation is benzoylic bromide out of the same reason, because the benzoylic radical is stabilized. So just with magnesium and rapid addition of the bromide, this diphenyl ethane is the dominant product. With a less reactive chloride, once again, magnesium in diethyl ether, and slow addition we can get to that benzyl magnesium chloride in a satisfying, very good 93% yield. And in organic synthesis, you know, these are the procedures that have been checked by other groups and are therefore very reliable. I found a procedure for producing rather large amounts of allylic magnesium bromide in yield up to 89%, and it was done on a 3-mole scale. Just with magnesium in diethyl ether, activating magnesium as usual with iodine, and the secret to get to this product simply is to let that allylic bromide drop in very slowly, that the concentration of the allylic bromide is always very low. In this case, we let it drop in for 17 hours. And normally, we are not that patient, but this is necessary to get a yield like that. This was state-of-the-art approximately until the year 2000. And then Knochel Group from Munich University offered new ways to get to compounds like that, actually to form magnesium sensitive magnesium, organomagnesium compounds. Well, and this is simply based on the observation that you can also, with organomagnesium Grignard reagents, perform the halide metal exchange, just as we have it discussed with organolithium compounds. You certainly remember that endocyclic restriction test and so on for the mechanism of that. Yeah? 8 complexes as reactive intermediates. So, we have an equilibrium like that. So, and well, it depends on which side it is. Well, it depends on the hybridization of the carbon the magnesium is sitting at. Yeah? So, if we have here in this case sp2 and here sp3, then the equilibrium will lead us to this. So, clearly, for instance, bromobenzene plus isopropyl magnesium halide will give us an equilibrium by far on this side, and this reaction works very well also at low temperatures. And at these low temperatures, the formation of the Grignard reagents then becomes compatible with a lot of functional groups. One example of that is indeed bit elder. degrees, 12 hours, don't need that long reaction time, that's for sure. This has published by Prevost as early as 1931. But no one seemed to notice that until Paul Knoche came, okay, and did a great job with his group. Well, this type of reaction can be still improved. So a general scheme is, we have a functional group here. We use the isopropyl magnesium bromide or chloride or isobutyl magnesium halide in the presence of one equivalent of lithium chloride. This combination is even more reactive. Faster reactions of the lithium chloride seems to break up magnesium aggregates, the aggregates of that magnesium reagent, and the interaction increases as an outcome the nucleophilicity of this carbon center. This reagent is then called turbo Grignard. Reaction is done in THF, most of the time between minus 15 to 25 degrees, and so this result. And as functional groups are tolerated, for instance, esters, cyano groups, or methoxy groups, other halides. So in the next examples, I should, of course, show what nice chemistry could be done with these new methods from the Knochel group. So, a highly functionalized aromatic system, a benzoic acid methyl ester with a chloromethyl group in the ortho position and an iodo group in the meta position. Isopropyl magnesium bromide. This is an ALDER reaction where we hadn't found the trick with the lithium chloride for the turbo thing, but it worked just fine. Minus 30 degrees, 1 hour reaction time. At this low temperature, while the isopropyl magnesium bromide doesn't react with the ester, but the halide metal exchange is rather fast reaction, preferentially at the more reactive iodide. So, and at this low temperature, this is stable at least for a while. Then, an isocyanate was added at minus 10 degrees. Of course, you have to add those reagents in pre-cooled solutions. So, from minus 10 degrees and let it increase the temperature to 23 degrees, essentially room temperature. So, what will happen? The aryl magnesium undergoes a Grignard reaction with a carbonyl group. So, and then you have two nucleophilic centers, an ambident nucleophile, the oxygen, and the nitrogen. The nitrogen wins the race with intramolecularly reacting as a nucleophile with the benzyl halide. The final outcome of this reaction, of course, ring closure, an isoindolinone functionalized with an ester, 75% yield. So, works very well. Another interesting example dinitroiodobenzene. With a Grignard reagent and THF at minus 40 degrees, very fast reaction, we claim that it's done after 30 seconds. So, and then of course they had to trap this Grignard reagent. Well, I think they had to be rather fast in performing that reaction because Grignards react with nitrate groups. And again, the Knochel group studied the reactions of Grignards with aryl nitro compounds. Here, an intriguing example. The 4-iodobenzoic acid ethyl ester with isopropyl magnesium chloride, minus 20 degrees, 30 minutes. So then we have the aryl Grignard with the ester group present. They added the nitro-substituted bicyclic heterene, this one, a benzothiazole, 2 hours reaction time at minus 20 degrees. Then they added iron chloride and sodium iron 2 chloride and sodium borohydride, still at minus 20 degrees, warming up to room temperature overall 2 hours. The aryl Grignard had reacted with the nitro group. Something was formed then, and that something was reduced afterwards. And this secondary diaryl amine is isolated in 77% yield. While to my knowledge there is a small drawback, 0.5 equivalent of that. You need for that reaction, to my knowledge, 2 equivalents of this. So let's have a look. What's going on there if a Grignard reagent reacts with an aryl nitro compound? So. In analogy to the 1-2 addition process of Grignard reagents to a carbonyl group, the first glimpse we would tend to make the addition reaction nucleophile attacking here at nitrogen. This is not true. The aryl group attacks the oxygen. So, let's see what happens. Makes sense. Then an elimination reaction takes place. We get the nitroso compound plus, well, aryl prime OMGX phenolate. Magnesium phenolate. Then the second equivalent of the aryl magnesium aryl prime magnesium halide reacts with the nitroso group, and this time it reacts with a regioselectivity we would have anticipated before, connection of the aryl group with that nitrogen. So, aryl prime, oxygen, MgX here. If we then hydrolyze this magnesium alcoholate of this bisaryl hydroxyl amine, we would get this bisarylated hydroxyl amine, and these are generally air sensitive. Oxidation with molecular oxygen giving nitroxyl radicals. So itself important as radical scavengers in rubber industry. So nevertheless, sensitive compounds and working the reaction mixture up and hoping for getting some nice clean products out of it was in vain until, again, Paul Knochel's group came up with the idea, well, before working up, we should put in some reducing agents. So, and a simple but so nice idea, reducing and getting to these nice bisaryl amines. Finally, let's have a look for two other applications from Knochel's group, where they used the turbo Grignard in combination with other organometallic reactions, also catalytic organometallic reactions. And you can imagine that this iodo compound with the exocyclic double bond is quite sensitive. Turbo Grignard, THF minus 40 degrees, 4 hours reaction time. Gives this Grignard reagent with dry zinc bromide. They did a transmetallation. And the organozinc species they needed for the palladium catalyzed so-called Negishi coupling reaction with this vinyl bromide. So it's a Negishi coupling. Isolating this highly unsaturated and, well, that's for sure, rather sensitive product in 70% yield. So, this alpha-beta unsaturated ketone with an iodide functionality at the beta position was treated with TMS nitrile. A clean addition reaction takes place at the carbonyl group. 1-2 addition process. A TMS protected cyanohydrine is formed. Turbo Grignard, again THF minus 40 degrees, and then again a coupling with the iodo analogon of that one. Well, they did that also with a transmetallation, a cuprate. Cuprate was formed. Copper cyanide. Presence of excess lithium. All right. So, And finally, with a reagent, TBAF, tetrabutyl ammonium fluoride. This is known as an excellent reagent to get rid of TMS protecting groups. So, then the cyanohydrine is set free and decomposes, giving free the carbonyl compound again. With this as the final product, and again a very good yield of 77% for this nice multi-step process. So next week on Tuesday we will go on with metal-specific features, once again about magnesium and the magnesium in reaction will be the first subject of next week's lesson. Thank you for listening. See you next week.